My name is Pedro Herrera. I am a full professor in the University of Geneva at the Medical School in the Department of Genetic Medicine and Development. So traditionally, I have been working on pancreas development using mice that we make transgenic in my own laboratory. And more recently, I have been interested in the exploration of the capacity of regeneration of the adult pancreas. So the central question that we are trying to address in my laboratory is whether the adult pancreas can regrow or regenerate new insulin producing cells after they are lost in juvenile diabetes. As any degenerative disease, diabetes results from the loss of cells, and in particular the loss of functional insulin producing beta cells. So to try to explore whether the pancreas can regenerate new insulin cells in diabetes, what we did several years ago is a transgenic mouse model of inducible beta cell ablation. So we made mice in which the surface of the insulin producing beta cells express the human receptor for the thyrotoxin, and with that we can, by just injecting once the toxin to a transgenic mouse, destroy all of the beta cells in this animal. So these are mice that are not diabetic, that are healthy, that don't have metabolic complications, and until the day in which I inject the thyrotoxin and I destroy all the beta cells. So the reason for doing that was to see whether in good conditions, by keeping the mice alive with insulin therapy, we see the regrowth of new insulin cells with time. So we did this experiment, and the first surprise was to see that in fact with time, new insulin cells appear in the pancreas of these mice that were completely ablated of the beta cells. So the second question was where these cells come from, because we have destroyed all the beta cells in these animals, there must be a source of new insulin producing cells. And we started to combine the ablation of beta cells with the inducible labeling of other cells within the pancreas, the genetic tracing of the cells to see that the progeny of these cells and see whether they can contribute to the formation of these new insulin producing cells. So by doing so, we discovered that the majority of the newly formed insulin cells in these mice are indeed non-beta cells that are reprogrammed, that become bi-hormonal. They start co-expressing glucagon and insulin, or somatostatin and insulin, and then finally they become only insulin expressors. And with time, this can even lead to recovery of the diabetes in mice that are 1 year old or something like that. So that was a very intriguing observation. We were very surprised because this plasticity is totally unexpected. So we wanted to explore the signals that drive this capacity of non-beta cells to start making insulin. And we made a number of experiments in mice. Some of them were the transplantation of islets. We were transplanting islets of transgenic mice or wild-type mice into host mice that were wild-type or transgenic. And by doing this, we could discover that this capacity of non-beta cells to start making insulin is somewhat islet autonomous, is independent of glycemia, is not driven by signals released from the exocrine pancreas, and that was also another surprise. We next wonder, of course, among other things, whether the human pancreas has also this capacity of regrowing new insulin-producing cells. So we started working with human islets from deceased donors, whether non-diabetic or type 2 diabetic, because we can dissociate the insulin cells and the non-insulin cells from human islets by FACS, and then we can purify these different cell types. We can transduce them with adenovirus to label them, to make them fluorescent, for instance, and we can re-aggregate them later to make pseudo islets. So with this approach, we can lineage trace these human cells, we can force the expression of transcription factors in these cells, and see whether these cells can also learn how to make insulin. So the question is not whether in the human pancreas the islet cells have this capacity of undergoing this change of functional identity like we see in mice. The question was more to find a proof of concept for the facultative induction of plasticity in human cells. And with this approach of making pseudo islets of isolated human islet cells, we observe that alpha cells and pancreatic polypeptide producing cells, and also probably delta cells that make somatostatin, can very easily engage in insulin production. And what is more, these alpha cells or gamma cells that make insulin are able to secrete it in response to glucose, like native beta cells do. So we made these pseudo islets of human alpha cells in the paper that was published, and transplanted them under the kidney capsule of mice that were diabetic. And we observed that these human insulin producing alpha cells, reprogrammed human alpha cells, can cure a mouse diabetes. The mice were recovered with these human cells that make human insulin, and these cells were stable. That was a very impressive surprise. And then we decided to profile these cells, these human insulin producing alpha cells, by RNA-seq. These are techniques that allow us to find the transcripts on a cell, the genes that are active in cells. We did it by bulk RNA-seq or by single-cell RNA-seq, and we did also proteomics studies in these human alpha cells that make insulin before transplantation or after transplantation. And we could observe that these cells, in fact, have acquired a few hundred of beta-specific genes, and that these few genes are enough to make these cells insulin producers and secretors in response to glucose in a very stable manner. So the thing now is to try to understand the molecular mechanisms of this cell plasticity, and find a way, using very ambitious approaches, epigenetics, systems, biology, you know, using CRISPR-Cas9, all these things, to see whether we can induce in a reliable manner the expression of insulin in these human non-beta cells. And to see whether we can find a pharmacological means or something like that could help promoting the plasticity of non-beta cells in the pancreas of patients with diabetes. What else I can say? I forgot something I wanted to say. Yes, one interesting thing that we observe in these human insulin-producing alpha cells is that because they have this hybrid character, they are not beta cells, but they are not alpha cells anymore, but although they keep a strong alpha cell personality, they can keep even glucagon expression, so they can be bi-hormonal. The interesting thing is that these cells could be less immunogenic in situations of type 1 diabetes. So we did a number of cytotoxic T lymphocyte killing assays, in vitro assays, using T cells from diabetic donors that were put in presence of these human alpha cells that make insulin, and we could see that these human alpha cells that make insulin are less immunogenic than native beta cells. So at the end, it could be a good idea to be able to stimulate insulin production in non-beta cells, for these cells could be less immunogenic in situations of autoimmunity.